For Barrow Neurosurgery residents, the end of the day brings teaching rounds where the most complicated cases are discussed. You're about to get insider access to discussions like you've never had before. Come with us as Michael Lawton leads us up a trail from the Barrow Neurosurgery Base Camp to the summit of neurosurgical excellence.
The next case was ACoA aneurysm.
What'd you take away from this one, Mohammed?
How big that aneurysm is, and then you need to go completely and dissect the entire dome before just putting a clip.
This turned out to be another tricky ACoA. I think there's a theme this week. This is Mohammed doing the approach. Did you take gyrus rectus before I came in?
I started a little bit. They're very medial and posterior.
So here's the problem with this aneurysm and the approach that we did. If you look at what's happening here, we've got the frontal lobe and we've got our suction here doing our dynamic retraction, and it creates this really limited view. We're trying to get up high to see this thing, and we don't have an OZ, so we've got a wall here to deal with, and we've got just a sucker here pulling up, so it's not really that effective. It's a really high aneurysm, so it's challenging. I think that's why this turned into something that was harder than should have been.
Should I have taken it before I even see the ipsilateral A2?
The additional gyrus rectus that I took out, it was still awkward. I needed a retractor. You can see how I'd taken a little bit more gyrus rectus here, and you can see now this is the A1. Ipsilateral, here's the A1 contralateral, here's the ACoM. We've got the A2 up here, and off the screen is the A2 on the other side. There's another example of an orbital frontal that comes off really early. That's what we're seeing here. And that, again, was locking in the gyrus rectus, making it hard to get into that junctional triangle. So when you get a view of this aneurysm, you see it's got almost what looks like a flat front to it. Pretty low front, but because we know what to expect on the backside, this is a posteriorly projecting aneurysm, we knew there was much more behind it. So that's when we decided to go with temporary clips. This is the contralateral A1. We put one on the ipsilateral A1 as well. All right, so now this aneurysm becomes nice and soft, and this is now going behind the ipsilateral A2. There's ipsilateral A2, aneurysm is up here, and what you'll see is that aneurysm goes all the way back behind it. So it's much more extensive posteriorly than you would think just initially. This is the contralateral A2 up here. The contralateral neck is in that plane over here, right there. You've got to get a clip that goes down the back side of this aneurysm. So what I ended up doing was to use a right angle clip. So this clip goes in this way, but then down like so. So it's like that. You can see the blade under there. Here's that aneurysm on the backside that is really hard to see. So this is the ipsilateral A2, contralateral A2, and it took that right angle clip. So you see how these blades are going down this way. You see how we're trying to get this portion of the aneurysm in there? You gotta nail that little cleavage plane there. You gotta line up this one here, and then you've got to hit this target down there. So I'm looking for the blade, there it is. Looking for the blade up in here, there it is. And then I've got to make sure I get all the way across to where that dome of the aneurysm ends. And you can see it's really difficult to line that up. So you'll see here that this clip isn't quite far enough advanced. I'm going to take a peek under here to look at the tips. There's the blade. But when I look right at the tips, it's not quite there. There it is, you see right there? There's just another millimeter beyond the tip. So we advanced it, and that took care of it. But that's a really awkward clip application because your clip has to kind of start here and advance down. And you could see it's a tough one to line up and get the angles right. But I think that was the ideal clip for that, because it goes down the backside, spared the perforators, and I had to move the retractor blade because I kept hitting the blade, getting that that clip in there initially.
Do you feel like taking more of it would help?
My name is Vasish Srinivasan, and I'm a cerebrovascular fellow at the Barrow Neurological Institute. Well, I've sort of figured that I wanted to do neurosurgery the first time I saw it. It was almost like love at first sight. I was doing research between college and medical school, and I knew I was going to go to medical school, and I was interested in some sort of surgery, and I saw it for the first time. My first day, I saw a transsphenoidal surgery, taking out a pituitary tumor, and I thought that was pretty cool. And then that afternoon, I saw my first cerebrovascular surgery, which was a ECIC bypass surgery. And as soon as I saw the beauty of the brain underneath the microscope, I knew that that was what I needed to do.
It would have helped. There's no question. No question. If you've got more space under here, it means you can look up. It's the same concepts we talked about the other day. You just get a much better view.
That clip application would have been very difficult if not doing it from the left hand. Obviously, from the left hand, you were hitting the retractor blade coming from the right side, and you'd have to fenestrate the lateral A1.
First hunch was a fenestrated clip, but yeah. It wouldn't work, and I'll draw that for you in a minute. But if I was going to do that right-handed, for me, coming in like this worked well. For you, or if I was right-handed, I'd probably shift myself this way and come in over the top and come this way with my right hand. It was the right clip. You can see the tips here. That's a beautiful view of just how that got all the way across the neck on the deep side. And about your question about the fenestrated clip, remember, this is the A1. The A2 comes off up here. If you fenestrate the A1 and try and get all the way down in that space, it's really hard, particularly when that cleavage plane on the opposite side is all the way up there. So it's not one that's fenestratable. I think you really needed a right angle clip on that. This is interesting anatomy. Tyler, I'm going to give you three structures to identify. That one, this one, and that one.
So you have your contralateral A1, contralateral. Yeah, that should be the A1.
It's what, A1?
Yeah.
Good, all right, so that's A1. How about two?
Yeah, that's A2.
Is A2?
No, three.
Oh, this is A2, okay. So that's correct, and that's correct. So what's this?
It's an accessory.
Yeah, it's a very strange accessory that actually, if you think about this, this is the A1 coming in. This is where the A1 and the A, sorry, that should be an A2. This is the A1-2 junction right here. This is a trunk that's coming off of the distal A1. So it's probably either like a colossomarginal or just an accessory branch that comes off the very distal A1. But that's very unusual anatomy. And how about this artery right there?
It's coming off that accessory. So I guess that would be the orbital femur?
That's your recurrent artery of Huebner. It's actually coming off of this artery here. And it's following the A1 back. So very unusual. This is, you know, your normal anatomy is basically A1 to A2 and A1 to A2 here and ACOM there. So this is an extra with the recurrent coming off of it. So that aneurysm was kind of like that. You know, the right angle clip getting across the neck like that on the backside. Fenestrated clip wouldn't have worked. You know, it's just too much. You know, this origin of the A2 is up here, and you'd have to fenestrate the origin here and then somehow get the clip going down, but it'd still be tough to get that portion of the aneurysm out. That case shows you how you really need to know your clips. The nurse is going to hand you a tray of 200 clips of all different sizes, shapes, and configurations. As you're staring down that aneurysm, you've got to know which one you're going to pull from that tray to use. That's really where all the action is. If you don't do that right, then all those preceding steps don't matter. When we think about aneurysms, we talk a lot about the dissection steps, the approaches, the anatomy of the aneurysm. You probably don't spend enough time talking about clip application or clipology, what clip you're going to go with when you finally finish all those preceding steps. That's why it's so important to understand all of them, figure out what they can and can't do, and have in your mind a construct that you think might work. Applying the clips is often the part that the attending comes in and does, so it's an important thing to hit the rewind and look at exactly what happened and really break down those steps.